First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
All right. Back again with Dr. Aileen Bay's show. All right, tonight's discussion is going to be on the true origin of the 4th of July. Now, before we get into that, we got several announcements to make. Number one is about the coming up event of the Healing Wings Institute Holistic Health and Wellness Expo. I think that all of you should be exposed to this information. It's going to be information dealing with Qigong, Tai Chi, Reiki, Pranic Healing, which is Pranayama, Kundalini Yoga, Tantra Kriya Yoga, and many, many other forms of healing modality. That's what we're going to be dealing with. All right. So I think it's going to be something very special. A lot of information that I know that y'all never heard before will be expressed on the healing tip, as well as also we have special guests in which that deals with raw vegan food preparation. We got people who are masseuses with acupressure, reflexology, itisology, and etc. So it's going to be a very special event. The event is going to take place at the Tremont Plaza Hotel in Baltimore, Maryland, August the 3rd, 4th, and 5th. That's that Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So come on out and support us. It is being held by myself. I'm the host, Dr. Aileen L. Bay. And this is something in which they'll be trying to get the whole East Coast into. So from Florida to Maine, we're trying to get y'all to come into the middle port, which is Baltimore, Maryland, in order to suck up some of this information. All right, so you got that. And we're going to get into the last two songs that we just played. You had Highest Learning. Let Me Take You to a Higher Level by KRS-One and Tai Chi by Killer Priest. Expand Your Mind. On both of these, is going to be definitely the topics of tonight's show, dealing with this information tonight. Information that you probably never heard before. So we're going to get into that right now. All right. For many who do not know my information, you will find that I'm one of the first in order to bring this information to the mainstream, which is Benjamin Banneker, who is known within the Moorish circles as Chief Justice Bembe Emmanuel Muwali, that he is actually Prince Hor of the Freemasons, Prince Hor of Freemasons in particular. All right. Now, how we come to this conclusion, we're going to go through it. But before we go there, there's a special group on which that is spoken about. If you get the book, George Washington's Masonic Connections and America's Secret Destiny, is written by R. Swinburne, Claimer, and Dr. Paul Riccio. And they basically write about the Witch of Hickon, which is a word, an indigenous word, but it was synonymous with a pure mystic religion. And this mystic religion became basically the American Rosicrucian Supreme Council. And this is what it says, is that with the freedoms of all religious sects, for it was here that there was many sectarians establishing themselves with the founders and the founding of the American Republic, because here was conceived the Constitution, and here was held the first American Rosicrucian Supreme Council. Here was Washington, also in here formed the Grand Temple of the Rosicrucians. So Wichita is beautiful, and to many of us, sacred as guns is to a Hindu. Now, just remember that word, Hishahikon, because you're going to go back to that word. Very important word, because it ties back into your heritage. If you get another book called Our Story of Atlantis, or The Three Steps, it describes that part, the mystical teachings of the Hishahikon played in the founding of America. They speak about that there's no doubt that Washington was familiar with and admired several of these mystics and occultists. And it says such as Peter Miller and Conrad Bassett. Now, that's important to understand, because you come to find out is that they helped Benjamin Banneker actually draft the Declaration of Independence, hence July the 4th. But they didn't tell you that this mystic group called the Witcher Cult, in which that is a Rosicrucian group, which obviously Benjamin Banneker was not just a Mason, hence Prince Hall, but also a Rosicrucian, or Rosicrucius, is the one who actually put the Declaration of Independence, or drafted the Declaration of Independence, along with Peter Miller and Conrad Bassell, in which they helped with the translation, in which that they got from the Iroquois. Okay, even though the history tells us that Thomas Jefferson and Benjamin Franklin supposedly sat under the Iroquois in order to learn of their peace law, but these are the individuals who actually translated it and drafted. Was Benjamin Banneker, Chief Justice Benjamin Banneker, or Bembe Emmanuel Muwali. And Bembe was the Abenaki, all right, of the tribe of the Empire Washita. All right, and you will see how the word Washita and the word Wishahikon ties together in a minute. But we get into Peter Miller. You know, he was a trained linguistics. You know, and him and Conrad Bassell helped translate the Declaration of Independence into seven languages after the drafting of that Constitution, which is the Declaration of Independence, by Chief Justice Bembe Emmanuel Muwali. Now, you can read this in America's Secret Destiny, Spiritual Vision and the Founding of a Nation by Robert Hieronymus, PhD. and also the Founding Fathers Secret Society, Freemasonry, Illuminati, Rosicrucians, and the Decoding of the Great Seal by Robert Hieronymus, and The Secret Destiny of America by Manly P. Hall. All right? Now, of course, they try to leave us out of the scenario. However, we know these bits and pieces based on the Moorish legacy. So let me explain a little bit further about Benjamin Banneker, Bembe Emeye Moali, or from the Banneker tribe, which is the Lenape. All right. He was the Chief Justice Bembe Emeye Moali. He was Prince Hall. All right. Prince. He was a prince that built halls or lodges or temples. Hence the origin of the name Prince Hall. It was a pseudonym. Now, how we're going to get to that is just keep following me here for a second. So, he was from the Abenaki or the Lenape tribe, in which that means the father of the serpents. All right. He was also called the Serpents of Wisdom. All right. Now, they also referred to nowadays as the Delaware Moors, as well as also the Ben Ishmaelites. Right, these are families that lived throughout Delaware, Philadelphia, Maryland, Virginia, area. All right, and Benjamin Banneker was actually the head of the Order of the Mystics of the Wishakone. All right, now the Wishakone is actually spelling is for the name U A X A S H A K T U N or O U A C H I T U N. Which is the plural for Washitor, the Oshetonk. So Washitonk is Oshetonk. This is what is going on here. So when they speak about an empire, it was the Empire of Washitor, the Dugdamonya. And who sat at the head of the order of that mystic order at that particular time, not the head of the empire, but the head of that particular mystic order of the Oshetonk was Benjamin Banneker, in which that, of course, we get the later Europeanized name Washington. All right? Now, when we get into the Declaration of Independence, you know, that's what was just celebrated last week. All right. And in numerology, you have a lot of codes. But I won't go through the codes right now because it takes some time. But what we will do is get back into Benjamin Banneker, because it's very important for what we can verify in history who is who. All right, so the following story, general stories told about Benjamin Banneker is that he was born November the 9th, 1731. He died October the 9th, 1806. And he was a so-called mulatto, born of a pair of unusual grandparents. Banneker, an African prince, okay, and Molly Wash, a Welsh, an Irish white woman. This is what it said. She bore Banneker's mother, Mary Banneker, and Mary married an African from Ghana named Robert. Now, of course, you know that his name was not Robert, but he was a Gold Coast tribal chieftain, okay? And supposedly Robert was brought here in chains, but later he was freed. And Robert took the last name of Mary and became Robert Banneker. And so Benjamin Banneker was allegedly seized in some part. Robert Banneker was allegedly seized in some part of West Africa. Some say that Benjamin Banneker was allegedly seized in some part of West Africa as a boy between 11 and 14 and brought to New England by a slave trader and sold as a slave. So we have a lot of misrepresented history just within that paragraph right there. All right. Then when we get down to who is Prince Hall, it says Prince Hall was born 1735, died December the 4th, 1807. So as you see, Benjamin Banneker and Prince Hall existed during the same time period. Prince Hall dated and birthplace, however, are subject to conjecture. He may have been born in England, Massachusetts, or Barbados, and his year of birth is generally recorded in either 1735 or 1738. So they don't even know when he was born. The Clock of Destiny, Volume 1, written by Dr. Charles Moseley Bay, 3rd degree, 32nd, 33rd, 360 degree, Amorish astrologer, states that no papers have ever been found on him by the church or by state in Barbados or Boston. The place of his birth is unknown, right? The descent with his birthday, 1735 to 1738, does not help either, right? Now, you can get this information also from www.stmarks7.org. /PrinceHallHistory.html, in which that states that Brother Charles Moseley, this is what he's, Charles Wesley, this is what he says. Charles Wesley says this. He says the problem with constructing the life of Prince Hall is concerned with his history, which we know have been related to traditions, unreliable sources, and the imagination of one writer in particular, William Grimshaw, who was a Prince Hall Solvent Grand Master. He also stated the absence of authentic documents and the repetition and defense of orators of fancy-filled tales has led to misinformation concerning our founder. So Prince Hall Masons don't even know who their founder is. But we continue on. Prince Hall said he has been born between 1735 and 1738. Masonic historians cannot agree on the place of birth. Some say that he was born in Barbados of the West Indies. And of course, that tales come from Grimshaw. While others claim that he may have been born in Africa. There is no evidence that we have access to today that gives us a clear picture of his birthplace. One widely circulated rumor states that Prince Hall was freeborn in the British West Indies. His father, Thomas Prince Hall, was an Englishman and his mother, a free colored woman of French extractions. Now, 11 countries were searched and churches with baptismal records were examined without finding the name of Prince Hall. The narrative stories of Prince Hall's birth and youth are unsubstantiated and appears to have been invented by their authors, particularly Prince Hall Grand Master William H. Grimshaw in 1903. So the question would be to Masons, why is the Sovereign Grand Commander or their master, Grand Master William H. Grimshaw, making up tells? But according to the most widely circulated version of Prince Hall's life, which originated with William H. Grimshaw, 1903's books, the official history of Freemasonry amongst the colored people in America have been strongly discredited. But most history books draw directly or indirectly from it with their own sketches of Hall. See, I didn't draw from those sketches of those particular books, even though I've read those books, because we found that Grimshaw cannot be trusted, and that his books has many errors and outright falsehoods about the life and times of Prince Hall. Interestingly, Prince Hall and Benjamin Banneker both died around the same year, around 1806, 1807. So in truth, almost nothing about Hall can be documented prior to 1770. According to Prince Hall Masonic Quiz Book, when you go to the Masonic Quiz Book, Prince Hall's supposed death date, December the 7th, 1807, was erroneous too. Traditions has it that December the 4th, 1807, this actually means no one knows for sure when he died. The question is, with all the dissent with the dates, how do we know when he died and the members of his own Masonic order do not know? The tradition has it that Prince Hall was buried in Coops Hill Burial Ground, but there is no record of interment. Sarah Ritchie, one of the supposed wives of Prince Hall, was the one actually buried in Coops Hill, and added many years later, carved behind her tombstone, read, "Here lies ye body of Prince Hall, first Grand Master of the Colored." Grand Lodge of Masons in Massachusetts, died December 7, 1807. So they added that years later to her tombstone, making it appear that it was Prince Hall's tombstone. Now, the lodge in which Prince Hall named was African Lodge 459. Therefore, it seems that the word African would have been used and not the word colored, which was not widely used during that time period in the 1800s. All right, they did not use that. Now, compounding the lack of recorded information is the existence of other said blacks named Prince Hall living in the Boston area during that period. You can go to www.africawithin.com/bios/princehall.htm. It says that Prince may have been another rather popular name, or was Prince really a title? This is what I ask. So two other Masons of Lodge 441 was named Prince too. You have Prince Rees and Prince Raiden. You have Prince Taylor was the African Lodge Junior Warrant, Grand Warrant. And upon Prince Hall's death, Neo Prince became Grand Master. Now, documents in Massachusetts showing that the slave owner William Hall freed a man named Prince Hall on April 9, 1765. Cannot be conclusively linked to any one individual, as there exists records of no fewer than 21 males named Prince Hall. And several other men named Prince Hall was living in Boston at that time. It is also unknown whether he was freeborn or a free man. According to the Prince Hall Masonic Quiz Book, Sherman fails to note that there were several contemporary Prince Halls residing in or around Boston, Massachusetts. On page 14, Dan replies to 10th September 1960, says, little did we know that our hero, Prince Hall, could have been an elusive or double character until recently. And it is fortunate for us at this time to know the facts, if any, in our day. Well, this day has come. Prince Hall is none other than Benbe Emmanuel Ali, Chief Justice of the Lenape Abenaki Washitaw Tribe. Now, In the Clock of Destiny, Volume 2, written by Dr. Charles Moseley Bay, he states that Prince Hall is only a mystic name. So also King Solomon, Hiram Abiff, Queen of Sheba, and David are only mystic names. Now, what does the word mystic mean? Well, you look up the word mystic, it means mysteries or esoteric rites or doctrines. All right, when you look up mystical, it says involves some secret meaning, allegory. Now, the word allegory basically means symbolic, figurative. All right, this is what this means. So, Prince Hall did not exist as Prince Hall. It was a double elusive character by the name of Benjamin Banneker, who was a prince, as well also who built halls or lodges, because it is a known fact that Benjamin Banneker, Benbe Emmanuel Ali, built Philadelphia as well as Washington, D.C. So, when we get down to the core of the meaning of the words mystic, it literally means not literal. Now, Pastor Ray Hagins, who is also a Prince Hall Mason, states that all spiritual belief systems, religions, are based on the life, deeds, and events of eponymous people that have been culturally literalized and incorporated into the cognitive reality of the people within that culture. And eponymy is a fictional character who a person or a group of people name or characterize themselves after for the sake of giving validity and can identify or give identity to their own existence. For example, the eponymous such as Adam, Noah, Ham, Shem, Japheth, Abraham, etc. Thinking that these people actually lived so that now people can come along and say that they're God's chosen people, such as the fake Jews, known as, well, we can call them the Hasidim, or the Jewish converts after 70 AD, the burning of Jerusalem, when they converted, in which that they actually is part Russian. You can get the book called 13th Tribe by author Kessler, in which that he breaks that down, in which that he speaks specifically on these fake Jews, who is not Sephardic, who is not Falashian, coming in and now dominating with their Zionism and now dictate policy around the world. All right, they call the, according to the Bible, they're known as the Ashkenazim. Okay? This goes back to Revelation. For those who say they are Jews but are not Jews, but actually are the synagogue of Satan. So based on all the evidence, or rather the lack thereof, Prince Hor too is the Epami, at least the founder of said black masonry in the United States of America. He's a fictional character. The only other individual that actually born and died during that same time period that we know for sure is Benjamin Banneker, or Ben Bay Emmanuel Moali, Chief Justice. All right, and Prince, the United States of America, possibly the greatest speculative Mason, never met or encountered the greatest operative Mason. Remember, the lifetime for Benjamin Banneker was 1731 to 1806, and for Prince Hall, it's 1735 to 1807, the exact same time period. Just a few years difference in the birth and the death, just a couple. However, no one knows exactly when Prince Hall was born or died. Nevertheless, the Moors have uncovered the lies told behind Benjamin Banneker. Benjamin Banneker was not a so-called mulatto or African that recently arrived to America shores, but he was indigenous. He was indigenous. He was from right here, from the remnants of that last empire, the empire Washo de Dagdamanya, also referred to as the Songhai Ghanaese Empire, Malian Empire, in which that was partially of that, in which that is what brought forth the Malian Moors, known as the Omeks, who was actually part of the Dogons. And the Dogons were actually the ancient Egyptians who helped build the pyramids and the temples, along with the Twa people, referred to or misnomered as the Pygmies. The Washto, or the mound builders of the Tekin, and the pyramids, the Mirs builders. All right? They built the pyramids here in the Western Hemisphere, and the mounds here in the Western Hemisphere. All right? We know that the Ben Ishmaelites, in which that all of them actually, you know, you can actually say was part of, was a collective of what is now known as the Lenape, which means the nappy headed ones. All right. Matter of fact, this is where we get the word Nappy from. It's from the Lenape, which actually is the word El Nuba. In other words, the Nubians, which is the ancient Kushites, who was already here. And this is obviously seen as you go to the Grand Canyon, you will see Egyptian hieroglyphics, in which that actually was produced by the Kushites. If you get Herodotus, who was a Greek historian, he specifically states that Egypt was a colony of the Ethiopians, which is the Kushites. So one and the same people. Of course, they had differences, because you had borders and you had different agendas, but they were still one of the same people. You had the Wampanoags, you had the Nanticokes, Natives, all misnomered Indians, who migrated to Louisiana, Alabama, Florida, Georgia, South Carolina, North Carolina, Virginia, Delaware, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, New York, Ohio, Indiana, Illinois, who referred to themselves actually as Moors. even though the United States government continued to classify them as Negroes in order to strip them of their indigenous rights. But that's why you do affidavits and put them on public record in order to stop being classified as three-fifths of a human being. And fall back up into Article 6, in which that deals with the Constitution being the supreme law of the land, its laws, and the treaties. Now, you can get this information from www.mu-atlantis.com, and they take it from the Moorish paradigm by Brother Hakeem Bey. All right. So there was never any Caucasian Benjamin Franklin. That name, according to information coming from Ali Muhammad, actually that was Robert Allen. Because the inventions and the designs of that from Benjamin Franklin actually is those same designs that of Benjamin Banneker, Bembe Mu Ali. So both the city of Philadelphia and Washington, D.C. bears the imprint of Benjamin Banneker. Design and two designs are based on a 52,000-year Assyrian alignment that is caused pole shift. If you get on Dr. Ali Muhammad's book, Benjamin Banneker, a true founding father, in his book he says that Benjamin Banneker is found in diplomatic intercourse with the Indians, the Abani, all right, plan of the Union, and that the Moors, Sharif Muhammad ibn Abdullah at Paris is mentioned in his almanac, and that the Congressional or the Continental Congress, the United States of America, would be the last great nation before the galactical pole shift and realignment of the universe and man. So Benjamin Banneker was the grand governor of this society. And Benjamin Banneker was also not just the grand governor of that particular society, but he's also the grand governor of the society of Tammany, which is the same similar to the word Tamaray, which is the ancient Egyptian's name, which was a secret society dedicated to the chiefs of the Moors that met with William Penn, the founder of the Quakers, hence a Rosicrucian sect in 1683. The name Tammany came from the Native American leader of the Lenape tribe, which are the Nubian Moors, right? And the name Penn became the name of the state Pennsylvania, okay? Now, the word Tammany comes from the word Tamaray or Tamor, which means the land of the Moors, all right? St. Tammany or Tamanid was chief of the Lenape, popular nickname. He was a saint. Tammany signed a treaty with William Penn of Pennsylvania in 1683. His motto was "Unite in peace for happiness and war for defense." His name was appropriated by New York City's corrupted Tammany Hall, Mount Tammany, and the Delaware Water Gap in St. Tammany Parish, Louisiana, territory of the Washington. And the state of Pennsylvania is named after, of course, as we said, William Penn. So now, according to the Moors, Benjamin Banneker is one of the two said blacks, Moors on the back of the $2 bill. All right? One is actually the first president of the United States, who is known as John Hanson under the Articles of Confederation. And Bembe is sat Masonically number 13 to the left at the front of the table. Now, according to the Masons' traditions, they told me, all right, Brother Super's 32nd degree Masons told me, 33 degrees now too, told me that Prince Hall is on the back of the $2 bill. But they have it as John Hanson. But they are correct. Prince Hall is on the back of the dollar bill. But that is Benjamin Banneker, Bembe Imanu Mu Ali. Okay? Now, the first Continental Congress met in Philadelphia on September 5th, 1774. And the Second Continental Congress assembled in Philadelphia on May 10th, 1775. All right, you had Peyton Randolph, who was the great-grandfather of Pastor Beverly Randolph, who was a Moor and a former Supreme Grand Master of all the Rosicrucians in the world. And the reason why he had that position or gained that position, Peyton Randolph was a Mason. All right. And then you had Henry Millington, October 2nd, 1774. And then Peyton Randolph became president again of the Continental Congress, May 10th, 1775. And then you had John Hancock. Remember when they say put your John Hancock right here? So John Hancock was also one of the presidents of the Continental Congress, who also signed the Declaration of Independence. All right, July the 4th, 1776. And he was president May 22nd, 1775. All right, so other Continental Congress. Now, you got to understand that this was our government. This is where the Great Seal comes from on the back of the dollar bill. Is from the Continental Congress. All right, this is our government. Their government is the up under the eagle or the phoenix in which that we gave them. But the pyramid and the eye is ours. This is why they try to make it Illuminati symbol. When you listen to these Christian so-called Freemasons now turn Christians, because this is the ploy that they are using in order to get you from researching this information. And I give you a little tell on what happened to me and my wife when we went to the United Grand Lodge of England. The curator of the museum part came up to us and said, well, how do you feel about the possibilities of your first black president? Talking about Obama, it was November the 3rd, and November the 4th was voting for. We already knew Obama was going to win, but we were still there in London at the time. So he asked us that question, and my wife said, but I thought there was already nine before him. And he jumped back like somebody hit him. Like Mike Tyson punched him in the face. And his hands were shaking. And he was like, how do you know that? You're not supposed to know that. Did they tell you that? So who's the they in which that he's referring to? He's talking about his Masonic white brothers here in America. Did they spill the beans on who we were? That we are the actual founders of this government. The Moors. It was our government, the Continental Congress. So we're not supposed to know this information that I'm giving and expounding on. But this is what happened. When I went to the library portion at the United Grand Lodge, I told him, I said, I want all your information on Prince Hall. The guy printed me up about 5 sheets of paper with all of the books that they had on Prince Hall. And he told me that the next time I'm back in London, that they'll come and pick me up from the hotel, get me breakfast, drive me there, and take me back. And in the midst, let me read and examine all of the documentation that they have. So when we're talking about this, we're talking about information in which that is now being expounded on, in which that has never been expounded on before. But now they know we know. So then the curator of the museum part comes and says, well, you know, the Indians were barbarians. And that was a key word. And I told my wife, don't get upset. The word barbarian comes from the word Berber, which means Moors. So he was saying that you knew that they was Moors. So he was trying to see if we were Moors, if we knew our Moorish legacy in history. We didn't let on. We just continued walking and going through the museum part. So sometimes you don't have to show them your card. But we do know. So other Continental Congresses were held in Boston in 1776, 1777. So as you see, even during the signing of their Declaration of Independence, we were still holding our Continental Congresses. Philadelphia, 1777. Lancaster, Pennsylvania, 1777, York, Pennsylvania, 1777, 1778, and Pennsylvania, 1778, 1781. The fifth president was Henry Lauren, November 1st, 1777, John Jay, December the 10th, 1778, Samuel Huntington, September the 28th, 1779, Thomas McCann, July the 10th, 1781. All right. So, yeah, all of them under the Continental Congress. During the signing of the Articles of Association of 1774 and the Articles of Confederation, 1781. All right. Now, who helped with the Articles of Confederation was John Hanson. All right. Who served as president under the Articles of Confederation and is considered as the first president. If you get the Articles of Confederation, if you go to www.johnhanson.net, you will see. All right. November the 5th, 1781, November the 17th, 83. All right. He becomes the first president of the Articles of Confederation. And interestingly, there was no state because the first state was Delaware, which was not ratified until December the 7th, 1787. So what territories were they referring to? They were talking about the colonies, all right, in which that became the corporations. But then you had the territories of those colonies in which that was still up under the Continental Congress control, while the colonies were under the Virginia Company, in which that the Virginia Company becomes now Washington, D.C., the said federal government. But what supposed to have tied everything together was the fact that it would be up under a British, up under a republic. All right, according to the Constitution, there's only one form of government, and that's a Republican form of government. But they sold us out to the British and defeated the last remnants of the Moors from the inside. All right. Now, in 1781, the Articles of Confederation also established a league of the 13 colonies or states, as they became known as, rather than a strong central government, provided for the continuance of Congress, known thereafter as the Congress of the Confederation. All right. That's what it became known as. Now, how do we know that John Hanson was the first president? It's real simple. George Washington referred to the presidential election of John Hanson by writing, "I congratulate Your Excellency on your appointment to fill the most important seat in the United States." So if George Washington was the first president, and he didn't become president until 1789, then who was running the government from 1776 to 1789 for those 13 years? Actually, it was Moors, and that's the reason why they have a problem with telling you about these Moors who ran the Continental Congress up under the Articles of Association and up under the Articles of Confederation, which is about 16 of them, prior to George Washington. Because there was two governments in North America. One was the Moorish federal government, and the other is the European state government. The fact can be observed on the back of any, you know, dollar bill, Federal Reserve note, or IOU fiat note. There's two national seals on the back of the dollar bill. All right? A pyramid on one side and an eagle on the other. The pyramid represents the Moorish federal government, and the eagle represents the European colonies. There are 13 states based on the 13 Lenape tribes called the Fire Clans. And the European colonists were adopted into the first of the 13 tribes, which was known as the Eagle Tribe. So these 13 tribes were patterned after the 13 clan mothers of our matriarchal government. The Iroquois finally succeeded in overthrowing our government by tricking us into accepting the role and the position of the woman. Later, the four of the six nations of the Iroquois themselves were conquered by an insidious plan put into action by the colonists and the British. Prior to the Revolutionary War, to the Moors stood in the center holding the chain of friendship, and the Europeans were at the other end of the Indian nations on the other. They controlled the Delaware River, originally called the Lenape, Wahikont, or the Lenape River. The Moor side of the government trusted in nature and nature's god. All right, Kachi, Manitou, or Anu for their guidance. The two nations can be seen in the preamble of the Constitution of the United States. All right. Matter of fact, it says, as you can see, the preamble of the United States of America, it says, we the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and to our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. Right. So as you see on the preamble, the Constitution of the United States of America speaks of two governments, the United States and the United States of America, to form a more perfect union. All right. First of all, you cannot make something more perfect. It's either perfect or it's not. So that tells you that this new union would be a legal fiction, a de facto unlawful government. The new government did not apply to the Moors. We were not and still are not Union state citizens. Our government was and is separated from the Albion European government. However, the Moorish federal side of the government has been infiltrated and has become the legal fiction. All right? But you never see them using our seal on any documentation. They always seal it with the birds. They never seal it with the pyramid because that's our seal. That's the great seal. So the preamble of the Constitution of the United States of America shows that the origin of this of the government came from a pre-existing nation. Notice that the Moorish federal side of the government has the word Anuit, Cleoptic, which is supposed to mean God has favor, but the Latin word for God is Dios. The word on the dollar bill is Anuit, or Anu. Therefore, it means Anu has favored us. All right? Some Moors say that John Hanson, who was a Moor, was at the Independence Hall during the signing of the Declaration of Independence. Some say that he wasn't. However, the picture of the on the back of the United States $2 Federal Reserve note, fiat IOU note, clearly shows the presence of two Moorish men, aka black men, on the back. So the question is, who are they, and why aren't they listed amongst the list of signers of the Declaration of Independence? That's the question. That is the question. Well, I already answered it, really, is because we had our own government. But if you look on the back of the $2 bill, the man on the left is John Hanson, and the man on the right is Ben Bay. Ben Bay was born 1731, as we said, making him about 45 in that picture, while John Hanson was born 1721, making him about 55 in the picture. He's the one with the gray hair. Now, if you look at Encarta Encyclopedia, you will not find either of these men. Why is that? Their names are not on the Declaration of Independence because they were both Moors. And we had our own government. We did not sign a Declaration of Independence. We wrote the Declaration of Independence for them. Ben Bay, we told you, drafted it. However, George Washington and his cronies never actually severed their ties from King George, who was married to Queen Sophia Stuart, who actually was a Moor herself. As a matter of fact, King George was a Moor too. They did not win the Revolutionary War, however. It was a setup to trap and totally defeat the Moors from the inside. So we are taught in school. It's called a reconstructed history. All right? Now, these are the words spoken by John Hanson on July the 4th, 1776, because he was there. And matter of fact, he's the so-called mysterious man in which that appeared all of a sudden, just like, you know, they say about Jesus in the book of Acts, all of a sudden he just appeared amongst the disciples. Well, they say basically that John Hanson did the same thing, all right? And basically what he says, they may stretch our necks on all the giblets in the land. They may turn every rock into a scaffold, every tree into a gallows, every house into a grave. Yet the words of this parchment can never die. They may pour blood on 1,000 scaffolds. And yet, for every drop that dies, the axe, a new champion of freedom, will spring into birth. the British king may blot out. Boy, they just do not like me dropping this information. Always some technical difficulties when it comes to when we get real deep into some real information here. So it's no wonder, you know, because this information is pertinent to historical value as well as also to generations, because this is something that you can pass down to your children and your children's children, because this information is so potent and it's so historically correct, you know. So when we look at it, let's go back to it. All right. I'm going to start again with the words of John Hanson on the day of the Declaration of Independence, during the signing of the Declaration of Independence. These are the words that he said in order to get them men to start signing it. In particular, John Hancock, who was the first one to put his name on that line, on that parchment, because this is where the term "put your John Hancock right here" comes from. All right. As you know, he was also a president, as we just finished showing you, up under the Continental Congress. I'm going to They may stretch our necks on all the gibbets in the land. They may turn every rock to a scaffold, every tree into a gallows, every home into a grave, and yet the words of this parchment can never die. They may pour out blood on a thousand scaffolds, and yet for every drop that dies, the act of a new champion of freedom will spring into birth. The British king may blot out the skies of Kiach Nyato, which means Anu, the great spirit, from the sky, but he cannot blot out his words written on the parchment there. The words of Kiach Nyato may perish. His words, never. The words of this declaration will live in the world long after the bones are dust. To the mechanics in his workshop that will speak hope. Now you got to understand, mechanics in his workshop, that's Masonic terminology. To a slave in the minds of freedom, but to the coward kings, these words will speak in tones of warning. They cannot choose, but he signed that parchment. Sign it. If the next minute the gibbet rope is around, then the halls ring with the clash of fallen axe. Sign by all your hopes in life or death, as men, as husbands, as fathers, brothers. Sign your name to the parchment or be accursed forever. Sign, and not only for yourselves but for all ages, for that parchment will be the textbook of freedom, the Bible of rights of men forever. Nay, do not start and whisper with surprise. It is true, your own hearts witness it. Kiach Nyato proclaimed it. Look at this strange band of exiles and outcasts, suddenly transformed into a people. A handful of men, weak in arms, but mighty in Nyato-like faith. Nay, look at your recent achievements, your Bunker Hills, your Lexingtons, and tell me, if you can, that Kiach Nyato has not given America to be free. Okay, so these are the words of one of the two men on the back of that dollar bill during the signing of the Declaration of Independence. Benjamin Banneker, as we just told you, is Bembe Emmanuel Moali, a.k.a. Prince Hall, and John Hanson, the first president of the United States up under the Articles of Confederation. Okay? Now, this is also something interesting that we found out, is that according to Moorish paradigm by Hakeem Bey, he states that George Washington was initiated in 1752 in the Lodge of Frederick, Virginia. Okay? But guess who he was initiated by? All right? It was, that thing is Lodge 21, you know. But it's supposed to be, he was actually initiated by Benjamin Banneker, Bembe Emmanuel Moali. Okay, so this is some of the truer information that you have. All right, all right, all right. We got caller 314 from the St. Louis area. Come on in.
Islam or Grand Sheik Aline Bey.
All right, how you doing, brother L?
Doing all right, brother.
All right.
Yes. Yes, sir, brother. I was listening to you talking about Benjamin Banneker Bay and the code he used with Prince Hall.
Right.
I was Also thinking about the book I was reading, The Secret Teachings of All Ages by Manly
that's
P.
Right,
Hall.
Manly P. Hall, that's right. Mm-hmm.
And he had about Francis Bacon.
That's
and
right.
How he used his
that's right.
He used his King James as his Shakespeare as his code.
Right, that was his code name, exactly.
Shakespeare.
James. Mm-hmm.
And I was relating that to the how he used Prince Hall
right.
as also his code name, you know.
Exactly.
And I show how widely the Masonic annals, and also I never mentioned you. I also member of AMORC, Ancient Mystical Order of Rosicrucians, in here in St. Louis.
All right.
Which I was the chaplain of that lodge.
Okay.
As well, I have a certain certificates on my wall right now, showing that I was a member of that order. And I'm glad you really got on that topic tonight, because I really can relate to a lot of things you was talking about.
Right, and I'm basically showing all the connection between these so-called mystic groups, you know, so-called secret societies, and the establishment and founding of America, you know, government in particular, and that it was by the Moors, you know.
Yeah.
So of course this will be a history in which that they would love to sweep up under the carpet. However, the Moors are here in order to rectify the situation.
And see, when I was came a part of the Rosicrucian Order, that was before I became part of the Prince Hall Masonic Order. I wasn't aware at that time how deeply rooted was the Ouachita Moorish Nation had a lot to do with that. I was very unaware and ignorant of that up to recent times. You know, when I got to study under you and Taj Tariq Bey and Brother C. Freeman L., peace be upon him, that I was really amazed. You know, it really prompted me to join the Moorish Science Temple in this city here. But to my disappointment, they won't teach anything like you, Taj Tariq Bey, Hakeem Bey teaches. No. I can relate to a lot of the year that the Rosicrucians was here in 1693-94. They had set up lodges there, especially in the Pennsylvania area, where they had set up at. And I wasn't aware that Benjamin Banneken Bay had initiated George Washington. I wasn't aware of that.
Right. Exactly. Another good thing too that you know that we have found out, brother, and I heard this from the Empress first. All right, now there's another book that we can get on this subject matter, but basically what we found out is that George Washington, that we refer to him as, actually is Adam Weishaupt, who was the founder of the Illuminati, or the Bavarian Illuminati. All right, now we got letters from Washington views on the Illuminati, you know, which was very clear at first. He said he condemned them as self-created society, dealt them a blow that led to their disappearance. You know, when questioned about whether or not Illuminists had spread to Masonry in America, Washington stated that he did not believe that the lodges of Freemasonry in this country had societies or endeavors to propagate the diabolical tenets of the former, which is the Illuminati, or the precocious principles of the latter, Jacobinism. Now,
mm-hmm.
Jacobinism, of course, is the same as Zionism as it is today.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is from a book by Sparks in 1848. All right? Now, and also from a letter during that time period that is found. It says, now, after the switch of Washington, who is now Adam Weishaupt, all right, because people don't know that Adam Weishaupt left from out of England or out of Austria and came to the Americas, you know. But remember, he was a Jesuit priest.
Mm-hmm. I heard that.
So he was one of the assassins of the Vatican. And he killed Jorge Washington, which is George Washington as we know it as, all right? And
mm-hmm.
Weishaupt now states, if you get another letter by Washington, or who was actually Adam Weishaupt, he says, it is not my intention to doubt that the doctrine of the Illuminati and the principles of Jacobinism has not spread in the United States. On the contrary, no one is more truly satisfied of this fact than I am. So as you hear from the two letters, you know, written within a couple of years apart, one minute he denied it, you know, or, you know, he condemned it as a self-created society. Then the next minute, he's more satisfied. And you can find that letter in the Library of Congress, you know.
I didn't know that.
Right. So when you're talking about Washington, you know, we're talking about the one before 1789, you know, who was Jorge Washington, you know what I'm saying, who was part of this same government design. And then Adam Weishaupt, who came in order to incorporate his Illuminati agenda into the whole thing. And so now we're seeing all of this takes place. And see, when people don't understand that, when you look at the word Washington, Washington, Ashita, which is another, which actually means mothers and fathers of the mystics,
mm-hmm.
right? Or fathers of the mystics. That's what Washita or Oshita means. Now, that word Oshita has the same meaning as the ancient Tamarian or Kemetic or Egyptian name of Washita or Ushet or Wajet, which is an eye. Which is an eye. And that's the reason why that eye is over top of that pyramid, because that symbolizes Washet or Washita.
Wow.
Now, people don't realize that because in the Bible, it tells you the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in his wings. Well, that is the symbol of the sun disk, which symbolizes the eye, which is actually the pineal gland, and then the wing stretching out, which symbolizes the expansion of the mind. So when you read that in Malachi, the 4th chapter, the 2nd verse, that's what it's referring to. Now, if you go to another book, I think it was written by Dr. Luwata Ashby, all right? He states from immoral, immemorable. It says the symbol of the winged sun disk, which is known as the Uwashet, has been used to signify freedom and the expansion of the mind, soul, and ra'atan. Now, in the ancient Egyptian myth of Osar, it is said that Heru defeated Set by becoming Uwashet. So we all must become Uwashet and defeat our Set, our lower self, because Uwashet mm-hmm. symbolizes the higher self, which mm-hmm. is winged sun disk, which is the all-encompassing divinity. This is the higher self in which that Prophet Obadrali was talking about, which is a form of Heru. But Heru mm-hmm. then defeats Set, which is his lower self, until he became Uwashet, or Washeshet, or Washita.
Okay, the Washetet, Washita, they said it has something to do with the all-seeing eye. I didn't know
that. The all-seeing eye, right.
I sure didn't know that. That's a new one on me, too. That's a more education I just got.
All right, now you go to another book. As a matter of fact, Egyptian Tantric Yoga Guide to Love, Sex, and Marriage, Relationships, and Spiritual Enlightenment by Muwatta Ashby. He says the Uwashet is the epitome of the ancient Egyptian tantric mystical philosophy as it is still today. It is the supreme impossession of the understanding of all-encompassing, all-persuasive, absolute existence. Therefore, the wings are used by both gods and goddesses, Neter rules, in ancient Egypt mythology, because the supreme deity encompasses both male and female, all opposites, all existence, the state of androgyny. Thus, in order to overcome evil, the concept of opposites, it is necessary to discuss the all-encompassing vision of creation, wherein this understanding there cannot be evil since there is no duality, opposites. So that's what Washet symbolizes, or Washet, or Washita symbolizes, is when you have gone beyond duality. You have gone beyond Heru and Set, that battle. That battle is no longer waged. It is no longer the great Jihad or the great Armageddon within you.
Mm-hmm.
That battle ceases. That war ceases. And now you have come to one, now you have come to oneself, which is Allah, which is Ur-Ra, which is Washet. And you have now come back to that one eye. And when you read in Matthew, the 6th chapter, the 22nd verse, when your eye be single, your whole body will be filled with light. This is what it says that Jesus states to the disciples.
Yes, I was studying a lot of that in your book, The First World Order, which I must highly commend you on that.
Thanks.
You did a superb job on that book, brother. That's not a page that's not highlighted. That I haven't highlighted or hardly in that book, because there's so much information and so much information so deep. A lot of them I have never heard of, and I by studying Rosicrucian philosophy and symbolism and allegory and Masonic, which is both about the same anyway. And I thought I really kind of close to getting on top of it. I'm finding out that I'm nowhere near it. Nowhere near it.
Right.
Each time I read your book, each Wednesday, I listen to you talk and speak. That's why I had sent for the books, The Moorish Paradigm,
right,
by Hakeem Bey. I don't know if you got the money order yet, but I sent it for them books.
Okay.
So I know you had explained to me and explained some of the things, but bringing Moors out of this false Christian philosophy and doctrine that a lot of us are in.
Right.
Yes, and but like I said, dealing with a lot of I had a discussion with the grand lecturer of this Missouri, the Pensaw Grand Lecturer of Missouri, and he asked me about Benjamin Banneken Bay, and I said, why are you asking me about that? I said, a Moore named Eric Legrand Hill told him Benjamin Banneken Bay was Prince Hall.
Right. Well,
and he had a problem. He had a real problem with that.
Right, I know.
And
but,
I said, "Well, I don't see no evidence of that. I don't see no evidence." I said, "Well,"
but that's the reason why I gave the evidence tonight, because I'm the one who postulated that information, because I've been teaching that information for over 10 years now.
Mm-hmm.
That Benjamin Banneken is Prince Hall, but that's the reason why I gave all my proofs in the beginning of this topic, in order to show how they have no evidence for the existence of Prince Hall. And that their own scholars say he was an elusive or double character. What does double character mean? And then why is the word elusive mean? In other words, they don't have nothing on this person from Barbados all the way to Boston, Massachusetts. So who is this individual? If he didn't exist, and there's 14, over 14 Prince Halls that they found in that territory, but none of them was him.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why it says it's elusive. And then it says it's a double character. What does double character mean?
Somebody's carrying a code.
Right.
Code name.
Right. It's a code name. Exactly. It's a pseudonym. So, I mean, who lived during that same time period and died during that exact same time period? There's none other than the person that I just made mention of, who went around building halls now, and who was a prince, and he built halls. He built Philadelphia and built Washington, D.C.
And you write about one thing, when they had it on his tombstone, he was a grandmaster, the first grandmaster of colored masons in America.
Right. Right.
They didn't use that term.
No, they didn't use the word colored. He used the word African. That's why it was called African Lodge 459.
Because I even heard, and I read it in your book, The First World Order, that African and Moor was interchangeable,
right?
At times,
right?
It was interchangeable, but the word colored did not come until the existence of much later,
right? That's the 1900s is when the word color was utilized. That was during the time of when the matter of fact the term color was used for mulattoes.
I know the word even the word Negro. What Harley used,
right?
That can't be correct, you know, because he like I said, the grand lecturer, he said he wanted to see some proof. I don't believe that, you know. They got to come up with some hard evidence. I said, well, the Prince Hall Masons haven't came in with any hard evidence at all about Prince Hall's existence, you know.
Yeah, right. Well, I have some questions here in the chat room. I'm going to go through them right quick.
Okay.
And it says, Dr. Aleem, are there any possible connection between Pastor Beverly Randolph and Ben Bay? Of course. They were part of the same Moorish order, which is the Rosicrucians. And, of course, Pastor Beverly Randolph was related to Peyton Randolph, who was the first president under the Continental Congress, as we spoke about earlier, who was a Mason as well as also a Rosicrucian. We talking right here with Brother L, who is a Mason, Prince Hall Mason, as well as also a Rosicrucian.
Right.
All right. You talked with Dr. Aleem Bay, who's also is a Moorish Freemason and also a Rosicrucian. So,
okay.
Yes, this existed 300 years ago. You know,
right.
So this is not something new. You know, and this is the reason why we can decode a lot of this information, in which that's been hidden from us. And for those who've been following my information I put out this past week or so on Facebook, there's been people who was upset about that information, but most were happy. You know, but I was breaking down the science of Lucifer and how it's is the angel Archangel Uriel and how it's actually related to the Kundalini energy. So you must raise Lucifer up. And, of course, you know, people didn't like that, you know, but if they read the book of Job, Lucifer goes up to heaven anytime that he chooses to and speak with God.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, while they was praying, according to the story in the book of Job, he walked past the angels as they was praying to God, and he started a conversation with God, and God responded back to him. So this is the misconception in which that when people read Morals and Dogma by Albert Pike and different others who say that we worship Lucifer, you know, they get the misunderstanding. No, Lucifer is the Kundalini energy at the base of the spine, which is the slowest vibration rate, is the color red. As you would know that if you study the chakra system, red is the lowest spectrum and the slowest spectrum. And this slowest spectrum is what formed the physical body into existence, or was able to draft or draw or magnetize elements, you know, to condense the human body, you know. So it was from this. But that energy fell from a violet state, all right? It fell from a violet state. The violet state is Melchizedek. The color for Melchizedek originally, who was known as Michael or Michael, the Archangel Michael, was violet.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't green. Green is the emergence or the middle or the pathway or the midpoint between the violet and the red. That's the heart chakra. So hence, okay, in Islam, Melchizedek, who is known as Al-Qadir, becomes known as the green one. And according to the teachings of the Sufis, Allah exists within the heart of man. So hence, Allah takes on that color green also. So hence, Michael within the Hebrew means he who dares to be like God.
Okay.
Or he who dares to be like El. And since El Law is the within the Hebrew, Allah is not spelled A-L-L-A-H. It is spelled E-L-A-H.
Okay.
Allah, which becomes the word Elah or Elohim, which is talking about all seven Elohims, which are your chakra system, all seven chakra points. And according to the 101 teachings of the Moors, it tells you that those seven Elohims was, is, and always will be, is what brought your physical body into existence. So it is your chakra points,
mm-hmm,
or your endocrine glands, that light in which that proceeded or superimposed over your chakra system is what brought your physical body into existence.
Okay.
This is what this is talking about. So what I'm doing is demystifying the scriptures that you've been reading all this time and showing you the connecting points. All right? So this is very necessary for we can get clarity on what is going on. All right?
Yeah, this is, a lot of the, when I was in the Rosicrucian Order, which was majority were Europeans, and in my lodge, and they were even telling me that about the Francis Bacon and Shakespeare, the cold Shakespeare, and they was got on the subject about the churches, and they said they were so disgusted with the churches, you know, And these were Europeans that were talking. And I saw, I was kind of amazed because I'm not saying that really. And I was just sitting up there listening. Because when I first joined, I had this European woman sit right beside me. And she was saying, I'm so sick of this Christmas stuff. It's Thanksgiving, well, Thanksgiving, but this Easter, all this Easter BS. You know, and I'm thinking, I'm like, you know, I wonder what this woman trying to do. She's trying to see where my head is at. That's exactly what she was doing.
Right.
And I was kind of amazed to see so many conscious Europeans.
Right.
You know, they were talking about a lot of the stuff, all this is not real, and the monetary system, and I'm like, wow.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, they know the same information we know, and this is the reason why they've been able to have a heads up on us, you know, over the last 400 years or so. But now that gap is being filled is because we're catching up as far as with information, thanks to the Internet, thanks to the hundreds and thousands and millions of books, you know, thanks to lecturers doing the YouTubes and, you know, so forth and so on. So this information is out there now. So they're going to have to contend with, you know, said blacks, you know, Moors knowing the same information and even knowing it better than they do, you know, who is able to put this information together.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but hold on, Brother L, we getting ready to bring in some more callers here.
Okay.
Caller 111, that means an unknown number. You're on the line.
Oh, good night, Mr. Bay. This is Deborah, the writer. I just want to thank you for the interview last week or 2 weeks ago with Tracy Piper of the Piper Center for Internal Wellness. And she also wanted to know, how can she listen to the show? It was on June 27th?
Right. She can go back and archive the show. Go to Blog Talk Radio and then just put in my name, Aileen Bay, A-L-I-M-B-E-Y, all together, and she can pull up the shows.
Okay, thank you so much.
All right.
All right, all the best.
Hey. Right, we got caller 732, area code 732, you're on the line.
Peace, brother. Brother, brother Okubar.
Peace, brother.
Peace.
How you doing, man? Listen, yeah, I'm here to advertise about the Moorish Rite Convention.
Yes,
August the 2nd.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So I want to expand that a little bit. I'm just here to just announce it to, you know, especially for the public. You know, I know there's a lot of Polish Moors out there that a lot of light out there, but we're trying to reach the public. I want all the Polish Moors to be there too. But this goes out to all the people that don't know about the Moorish Rite Freemasons, and also the Order of the Moorish Stars. That is the female counterpart. We want all you to come to this event. It's a great event. It's going to be speakers like yourself, brother Dr. Adio. I believe you'll be speaking there too at your lecture. You'll be there.
Yeah.
And also Dr. Hazel Bay, a great man of this time. He's an angelologist, and he'll be speaking on angels, and it is a great seminar. I mean, he communicates with angels, so that'd be a great seminar to sit into, listen to, and there'll be other classes open too. But it's really important that, you know, that our people get this information and get with our culture, because, you know, more, like I said, like you said, the Moors. And Moors, they, you know, chronologically, they were the first, you know, to bring this Masonic information around from the days of ancient Egypt up till now, you know. So, it's, like I said, you know, if anybody wants to know more information about this, about the Moorish Rite Freemasons, you can go on to ancientfreemoorishrite.org, and you'll find a lot of information on Angelo Solomon, which we consider to be the first Moorish Rite Mason from 1721 to 1796. He come from the Harmony Lodge, and he helped Mozart write his first symphony. So that little part of information I'm giving you there is like, you know, if you look into African American history, it kind of stops short of 400 years. Well, what about the rest of the history? What's about our history? Now, who is there to teach us that history? Every time we've been given it in dribs and drabs, but now under the Moorish right jurisdiction, you come onto this fold, you will get, you know, all this information, you know, dispensation to you, you know. But, you know, some of this information is sacred, so we try to leave out the profound and deal with people that have the potential to be initiates in this. So, but again, it's open to the public. We want you to come out this wonderful event. It's going to be a great event. It's going to be, you know, a lot of seminars, a lot of classes, you know. Again, I really stress the public to come out. You know, the hotel rooms are available. Okay, there's a $50 registration fee for visitors, and if you want a room, it's going to cost you $120 a night, and that I believe that's at the name of the hotel where it's going to be in
Right. Tremont Plaza Hotel.
Tremont Plaza
Hotel in Baltimore, yeah. Maryland.
Baltimore, Maryland, and that was on the 2nd of August through the 5th. Okay.
Well, the 3rd of August through the 5th. Yeah, August the 3rd, 4th,
yes.
And 5th. Yeah, Friday, Saturday,
right.
And Sunday.
Right, exactly. And you know, we are a non-religious institution. We accept all religions, but we don't really practice religion. So I just want people to know that, you know, we accept anybody across the board, any creed, any culture, any color, just come, you know, and learn about the Moorish history. It's very rich, you know. We go back from, from the days of Egypt, but even so, back into the profound times of, you know, Spain, you know, and Europe, France, England, Scotland, Wales, you know, Ireland, you know, I mean, the Moors were all over the world, you know what I mean? So I'm mixing it up, you know, so, I know, this information is here for whosoever desires it, and we're open to the public, especially for the public, you know. We get this information across, and, you know, we can break bread as brothers and sisters, and, walk the walk, you know.
Yeah. And for those who want the hotel information, I'm telling you, it's going fast. You better go on and get your seat, or better yet, your rooms now. It's the Tremont Plaza Hotel, located at 222 St. Paul Street, Baltimore, Maryland, and the number is 410-727-2222. That's 410-727-2222. All right, call for the hotels for your reservation. They're going fast. All right, and this is going to be the Healing Wounds Institute Holistic Health and Wellness Expo 2012 in conjunction with the Moorish Rite Conference. So you're going to get a lot of good information, all right, between these two conferences. So you're going to get two conferences, you know, with this valuable information from healing to your history. You know, you can't miss this. Or as the brother was saying, you want to be there. You know, so also for advanced tickets, you can call 252-257-3588. That's 252-257-3588. Also, vending is available. All right, it's $100 for the entire weekend if you want to vend. All right, you can't beat that. So, you know, come on out and support. All right, this is going to be very potent. I'm going to be there lecturing Dr. Clifford Hazel Bay, who's the sovereign grand commander of the Scottish Rite, and also one of the founders, is actually the founder of the Moorish Rite. All right, you have the Supreme Grand Master, Alain Bay, L. Day, who's going to be there. He's also going to be talking and going and taking people through the initiation process for those who want to go through the initiation of becoming a Moorish Rite or Freemason or up under the Moorish, the Order of the Moorish Star. All right, you have Brother Kair Love there. all right? Those who is into the Qigong and the Tai Chi, the reflexology, you know, that's the man. You know, you definitely want to get some of that. We got Sister Sashalom Iron Bay, all right? She's a raw food dietitian. She is almost 60 years old and looks 19. So she can tell you how to sustain a disease-free life. All right? So come on out. You're going to get the most potent information that you will ever have in your life. If you think that we be dropping on Facebook, you haven't seen nothing. You got to see this in person. You have to see this in person. You have to experience this in person. So come on out and check us out, all right?
All right, brother. Also on the mention, for the public to visit Ancient Freemoorish Rite online. Okay, and there's a lot of information about the Moorish history and the Moorish Freemasonry. And if they're interested, you know, there's contacts. We can contact us, and you know, we can have a dialogue, or you know, any information, any questions you got, we can answer for you. We're open.
Appreciate that.
Okay, brother. I'm gonna let you go. Okay, so
all right,
peace, brother.
Appreciate you. All right, we got area code 253. Area code 253, you're on the line.
Islam, Moore.
Islam.
Yeah, brother, you on fire. This is DJ Imhotep out here on the West Coast.
Yes, brother.
Oh, brother, I had my daughter here, and she had a couple of her friends over here, a little baseball team. A couple of the girls were little white girls, and they were hearing you go in. Man, you're changing the world with that one.
Oh,
you know what I'm saying? You hit him on the Achilles heel with that one.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, I think you should do a lot more shows like that. I mean, it was powerful, and the timing was, you know, her mom came, picked her up just maybe about 4 or 5 minutes right before you went off, so she didn't get to hear that part.
Right.
Man, that was powerful. I was like, hey, I can make you a copy of that one. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
You can go back and bring that back to him because you know what I'm saying? She was my daughter here all the time. My daughter doesn't really take it like it should be, but this little white girl was taking that to heart.
Right.
She was taking what you were saying to heart. I mean, I could see it on her face. But yeah,
yeah,
brother, that's all I wanted to say. I mean, you know what I'm saying? I could hear it in your voice. I mean, it was giving me the Holy Ghost.
Right.
I was like, woo, his brother is going in. And it was just, woo, that was a bad show. You know what I'm saying? The brilliant part about Blog Talk is, you know, because Aline, you're starting to turn into a superstar, a hero. You know what I'm saying? You're going to go down in his story. You know what I'm saying?
I got
one of those feelings like I was listening to Pac, or you know what I'm saying, where it's like, woo, that's hot. That's taking hip hop to another level. Yeah, brother. Let me let somebody else get on the line. I just wanted to, you know, kneel my knee to you. You know what I'm saying? And say Islam, Salaam Alaikum. You ferocious, brother.
Appreciate that. Yeah, we here uplifting fallen humanity. That's our purpose.
Yeah. I've been, you know what I'm saying, I consider myself a Moor, but you know what I'm saying, I'm not. You know what I was going to ask you?
What's that?
So you don't believe it's necessary for Moors to enter Prince Hall?
No, it's not necessary.
No.
But it is, if it's something in which that they want to do, then that is something in which that they can go through, because the rituals do have symbolic meaning, because within Masonry, there is symbolism and allegory, which can be decoded, which that can help them elevate to a higher level of consciousness.
Right.
So, I mean, if they choose to, then they can. They may. You know, I happen to, you know, I didn't go the Prince Hall route because I wasn't riding no goat and getting my behind wet. I was more into the intellect, more of the mysteries. And
yeah, brother. You know, saying God is free.
Right.
You definitely one of the gods.
So I went into the Moorish Rite Freemasonry. So we deal with the Moorish Rite Freemasonry, and that's what the brother we just finished talking about, who was just on the line. And also we got the Moorish Rite Conference coming up August the 3rd, 4th, and 5th in Baltimore, Maryland, in conjunction with the Hill & Wings Holistic Health and Wellness Expo. So we're coming together with Freemasonry and also with the science of healing, in which that you can't beat that, because that means you're going to decode a whole lot of mysteries. If people think that this is something on fire tonight, then they haven't seen or heard nothing yet. Wait till they come to this conference.
I can only imagine, brother. I can only imagine. I'm blessed to just be able to get you out this way, you know, saying, and that's a blessing for me.
Right.
You're a lot better than me thinking about trying to make money, because I dealing with my internal self it seems more potent than trying to search for wealth.
I got it. Because
it seems like that's where the wealth is.
Right. Well, that's where the real wealth is. You're right. No doubt about it.
Yeah, and you know what I'm saying? You light that up, boy. You light that up, boy. Woo! Woo! It's like, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? We don't got anybody who's really conscious, if you want to call that the word. You know what I'm saying? So, you know what I'm saying? When I hear a brother like you, you know what I'm saying? You brothers might, you know, hear other speakers or hear somebody else saying something on that same level, but you, Ali, man, you're one of us too. You're from that, you know, saying you're from that hip hop fraternity too. You know, saying you're from that
right.
hip hop lodge.
Right.
So you know, saying that's another PowerPoint for you. I mean, I wish I had $1 million so I could just say, here, brother, just do your thing. You know, saying like, here, I sign you. You got the deal. What you want? You know, saying how much distributing you want? You know, saying
right.
You know what I'm saying? Seriously, you become like, you've understood that there's an entertainment level to this
right.
lecturing, and
right.
and you're peeking out, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
You're peeking out, brother, you're peeking out. It's like, wow, I can't get enough.
Okay, appreciate that, bro.
All right, peace, baby.
See you, God. All right,
peace,
we got some more callers. We got area code 111. That's unknown once again. Come on in. You're live.
Yes, hi. My name is Hadia. Peace and love to you. I'm loving the show. Dr. Aleem, I really love your show. You really send out great information. I just feel all the great vibrations coming from you when you speak about the Ouachita. But my question to you is, you had mentioned something. I'm out here in Nevada.
Right.
In the west here, and you had mentioned something about the Grand Canyon.
Right.
Which I can be seen on the wall there.
Right.
My question to you, where and what location would I be able to see that if I was to go to the Grand Canyon?
Well,
I don't know if I'm allowed to see it, but, I'm out here and I wanted to check it out.
Right. No, they actually closed that part off and flooded it with the Colorado River. But it was an article from April the 9th. April the 10th, 1909, in which that came out, in which that stated that they found 18 temples there within the Grand Canyon, based on the ancient Kushite Egyptian information, in which that was known as the Temple of Ra, the Temple of Isis, which is Osset, the Temple of even the Temple of Buddha, which is Ptah. So all of these temples have actually been found there in the Grand Canyon. So we now know that the ancient Egyptians, who was actually the Kushites, were here in the Americas, dating back thousands of years ago.
Wow!
So you can actually see this article. You go to, matter of fact, you can go to David Childress, Childress, David Childress.
I'm sorry, could you say it again?
Childress. Childress. Childress.
Oh, okay.
Childress. And you can actually put his name in, into the internet search on Google, Grand Canyon and David Childress, and you can actually pull up his website with the articles in which that I'm talking about. And how there's been found over 18 different temples of the ancient Kushites Egyptians there in the Grand Canyon.
Wow. That's amazing. Okay, you really gave me the research to do.
Okay.
All right, thank you.
Come back on next Wednesday, and I'll tell me what you find.
Okay, thank you.
All right, peace and blessings.
All right, peace and love.
speaking on, sir.
All right, we got area code 404. You on the line? Area code 404, Atlanta, Georgia.
Peace and blessings, brother. How you feel?
Peace.
How are you?
Good, brother. Waters, Dwayne.
Yeah, I know. Voice sounding strong.
Yeah, I'm getting there, brother. I'm glad I peeped in tonight to get the information on the conference. All I'm going to say is that I want to go. And I'll probably be contacting you and seeing if I can get all the information again from you. Maybe I can get my brother to buy me a ticket to come up. But I would really like to get an opportunity to see you all and get on board again.
All right.
I just wanted to say hello to the family.
All right. Well, we definitely get you that information, Brother Waters. Just email us and we can actually send you the flyers and all that information.
I sure will.
All right. Appreciate you.
So you, Empress, I say hello.
I sure will.
Thank you. Peace and blessing.
All right, we got area code 732. Area code 732, you're on the line.
Peace, brother. It's Brother Ukbar again. I made a mistake with the online ancient free Moorish rite. I said it was MoorishRiteOnline.org, but it's not. It's MoorishRiteOnline.net.
Right. .net. Right. MoorishRiteOnline.net. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's what I quote for Bob. Just to make that corrected right there.
All right. Matter of fact, I'll put it in. I'll put that in the chat room.
Okay. Okay, brother.
All right. Thank you, brother.
Yeah. Thank you. Okay.
All right. Brother L.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Peace.
So any other further thoughts before we go?
Yes, sir. Like I say, I love just about the best of yet of your lectures on the video talk show. I hope we have more of these.
Oh yeah.
And I'm still studying. I've talked to a bus driver and another sister, and they said they're interested in Ouachita. Join the Ouachita and learn more about their heritage and culture and their nationality and birthright. And they should be giving you a call if they haven't called you already.
Right.
And me and Brother Yada Bay, I'm letting him borrow my fare so he can take the pictures to send to you for his papers. And I'm always talking about more science.
Right.
And so I'm always wearing my shirts, and people want to ask questions about the Moors, and they said the Moors did so much wonderful things, and they want to know more about the Moors and how they are related. And I always tell them, well, they are Moors, you know,
right,
themselves. And they want to know, one sister asked me, could she get her DNA? I said, yeah, if that's what you want to do, we'll trace her blood lineage, you know. Because I have a portrait of my great-grandmother. Found out she was a Chickataw, if I'm pronouncing the word right.
Right, Choctaw. Yeah.
Choctaw. And I was amazed. I said, I asked my mother again. I said, say that word again, mother. She said she was a Choctaw.
Right.
I was like, wow. And she's got the picture at her home. You know, and I'm gonna take a picture of that. I'm gonna send it to you and see. It's no doubt. She's very Aboriginal indigenous to this land. If you see her picture, and I'm like, oh man. So I'm more. I have more of a blood lineage to the Ouachita Nation than I thought I did.
Right.
You know, so this ain't no. Some Moors I hear from the temples. They say they don't believe it. You know, they don't that they're original from this land, you know.
Right.
But
right.
I have proof.
Yeah.
You know, so that's just about all. That's about all I have. I didn't get a chance to see Abe Lincoln Vamp Vampire Hunter because they took it off the theater so fast.
Oh.
They took it off so fast. I said, I went there to see it.
Right.
But get a ticket. I said, what? They took this movie off already? They wouldn't have been on there but a week. And they took it off. And I wonder whether they get it much ratings or what. but I think it told too much in that movie.
Yeah, it did.
That's why it lasts too long. And I'll find it, though, if I got to get it on DVD. I'll definitely find it. But anyway, like I said, I'm still working, still trying to be active. Like I said, I hope I sent enough money for the books I sent for the Moorish Pyramid by Hakeem Bey.
Right.
Like I said, if I didn't send it enough, just give me a call or whatever. Let me know.
Okay, I sure will.
More. And about your health and holistic lectures, I love those too because I'm definitely following what you had advised me to do.
Right.
Especially with the cayenne pepper and the golden seal. The echinacea,
right,
and it builds up my immune, trying to build up my immune system.
Oh yeah.
And I haven't sent off for the potassium chloride. What was that you said?
Iodine.
Iodine. I haven't sent for that.
Mm-hmm.
And I will send off for that soon though.
Okay.
Some more.
All right. Well, we appreciate y'all listening to the night show. Thank you, Brother L. And we get ready to head out of here.
First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio, every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns and existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance.
Order.
System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics.
Radio.
Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories, shit that works.